Take your Bibles and turn to Psalm 37, and we're continuing our series, our life series. God is not just wants you to exist, he just doesn't want you, and that Bible study is so fitting in this series that Irma Joy was talking about. There's more to life than just living, this series has been kind of pointing us in that direction. The series Life is actually taking two different books, Psalms and James. We're starting off with a series and just about to come to conclusion, and then we're going to switch over to the book of James. But life and some important aspects of life we've looked at so far in Psalm 37, delighting in God, how important it is in our life to make what is fulfilling and live for a joy that he gives, delighting in him. And then we looked at trusting. And trusting in God, and this is a main theme through this life series, in trust. And then there's the practical last week of not worrying, not fretting. I had a number of people talking about that, of how fretting is like an erosion. It's what you do to yourself. You're wearing yourself away. And remember, when you start worrying about things, too much worry is a red light, is a warning light on the dash of your life that says your faith is fading. The more that you are worrying and fretting, the more that your faith is leaking. It's not a big deal, except you just need to bring it into the mechanic. You need to deal with that leaking faith. And so now today, we're talking about commitment. We're all in. Anybody ever, when's the last time you heard the phrase, going all out for something, right? When I say, let me ask you, what do you go all out for? You think of that. Now, probably this was maybe the only major thing I drew on earlier on when I was in sports. I mean, I was not the tallest on the high school basketball team. I was one of the shortest guys on our high school basketball team. We had like giants. I think they were all Philistines, actually. We had got like 6'7", 6'8", you know, like these big, great. We'd go into games and they would all dunk and everything else. I was like the little guy. But what I would do was I would work my butt off. Sorry for the phrase, but you know what I mean. I give her. I mean, if a ball was on the ground, I'd dive after it. I'd run after it. Doesn't matter if a guy's ahead of me, I'd chase him down. I'm paying for a little bit now every morning when I get up. Some of those things I'm catching up to me, but I would go all out. Hockey was the same way. I mean, when I first learned how to skate, it was not really, hey, did you see that? I didn't fall down. It was like, did you see how fast I was going? All the guys that wanted to go around once without falling down, I drove them crazy because they were kind of who I used to stop. I'd just go, my legs would give her. I'd bang into boards, blue lines, linesmen, referees. I don't know what. I just go all out. I'm not saying it's necessarily the best model, but we can go out for all out for a lot of things. How many got that friend that when they get into like scrapbooking or fishing or into motorbikes or whatever, they just go crazy. Like they just, anything and everything you can buy on that thing, they've got. Like they just go, when they go for something, they give her, right? You think of the phrase going all out, putting that commitment to something. Commitment is the giving all of what you know about yourself to all of what you know about God. So this is why we're going to attach commitment today. And not in this kind of crazy, zany commitment that sometimes we're thinking of today, but what does it mean to be committed to Christ? Now, I'm going to probably challenge some of you. You might think, well, I've committed my life to Christ. Oh, how have you? How's that going? What does that mean? I committed my life to Christ. That's an interesting phrase, isn't it? That means you're saying that it's something you did. So what are you doing now then? If you have committed your life to Christ, are you today committing? What are you doing with your tomorrow? Is your tomorrow committed? See, I've prayed sometimes when we say, I'm committed to Christ. I'm committed to Jesus. It's an action of the past, not the present. The gospel doesn't cost us anything, but it demands everything. Demands we go all in, pushing everything into God's hands. Okay, so there I said it, all in. So I'm going to borrow from a poker phrase. I'm not going to ask a show of hands here when I talk about poker. But you know what I mean, all in. When they take everything I have, that which I know I have, that which other people may or may not know what I have, but I'm taking all I have, everything. And it's all in. God does not want partial commitment. Often we can skim over the surface of things. When we are all in, we are all invested. There is no contingency plan. There's no plan B, backup. We're not hedging our bets. Well, that's a lot of poker, a lot more poker phrasing than I'm qualified for, let me tell you. But sometimes we say, okay, I'm going to commit, but I'm gonna just hold back a little bit just in case this doesn't work out. Means committing your resources, committing your finances to Him. It means committing your talents, your gifts, your times, your dreams, your work. All. Become a part of the kingdom of God. We just do not receive Jesus' righteousness because of His work on the cross. And we will today conclude the service. In fact, we're going to do a little bit different today. I maybe should give you a heads up. But we're going to distribute and serve communion, and you're going to have them. I'm going to mention it like a little bit. We'll talk a little bit about it at the beginning. But after we partake of communion, they're not going to be talking. It's as soon as you eat the bread, and we do this together, and we drink the cup, and we'll do that together, as soon as we drink the cup, you are dismissed. Like as soon as. In fact, Pastor Call, as we were just doing a little game plan here in the back, saying, he said, just to make sure, you mean like right as soon as, yeah, right as soon as we drink it. Why? It's because then you are called to go. And yes, we receive, and often we focus on what we receive, the righteousness, his work for us, forgiveness of sins, His death on the cross and all its provisions. We focus on that, but today's focus is going to be the fact that He committed and laid His life down for you. And because He's laid His life down for you, I am calling you at the conclusion of the service to live for Him. When you receive that bread, yes, you're receiving the righteousness of Christ, but you're also receiving the responsibility of taking up your cross and following Him. Commit your life to Him. Receive salvation. Commit your life to Him and follow Him as Lord. And so as the conclusion of the service, as we do that, it's a challenge that we receive. His command is to follow. He wants us to commit not only our lives, but our ways to Him. Okay, so how many remember the game? Of course you do when you're a kid. The Hokey Pokey. Right? Some people think Christianity is hokey. My concern is it's hokey pokey. There are some that are putting one arm in and then one arm out. Or maybe a one leg in, right leg out. Shake it all about. Turn ourselves around. And then we'll come back next week and we'll put our left leg in and left leg out. Shake it all about. And that kind of describes sometimes a crisis experiential Christianity. I'll go in a little bit. I'm going to come out a little bit. I'll put that in a little bit. Come out a little bit. But never, ever, of course, would we go all in and all out. See, because the truth of the matter is, we like to just put a little bit in rather than everything in. It's a little bit unsettling when we commit everything. All of us, I think without exception, need a little bit of help offering our whole self to Christ. All of us need a little bit of help. I mean, we could do the offering. I mean, none of us can fit in an envelope. I mean, some of us, it might be a little easier than others. But if you were to put on, this is my offering envelope. I'm going to fit in my envelope. I'm going to offer God all of me. And the plate comes by and we get in there. I'm not sure Pat would be able to carry an offering plate with all the people in the middle section as you take up the offering. But the fact is, most of us don't come to a worship service or enter into a day giving our whole selves to God. If we're honest, we reflect back, take an inventory. We come to service and we may bring with us sins that may need to be confessed. We may bring with us concerns of our life that we need to hand over, questions that need to be answered, problems that need to be solved. We come to church bringing with us burdens that need to be lifted or anxieties that need to be dispelled. We come offering God frustrations or being preoccupied or distracted. But oftentimes we come to worship bringing things that is everything except what it is that God requires of us. Regardless of your concerns or your questions or your problems or your sins, all of those things aside, come and offer yourself as a living sacrifice. Lay yourself before God. Say, God, I'm here. I'm worshiping you. All that I have, all that's within me. All my, we've said this over and over again, but I really think we just say it. We have no idea what we're saying. To give him all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. Love the Lord your God with everything you got. Forget being reserved and held back. You hold back, you miss out. You can't partially jump across a chasm. I think maybe I'll just try to jump partway today. It's a leap. You must do it wholeheartedly. It's easier to take out a checkbook. Actually, now that I lift it that way, it might be easier to give in the offering. It might be easier to even double your tithes, your offerings, than it is to offer your whole self to God. Total commitment, our total life. The truth of the matter is, real worship is when we come, confess our sin, turn from that sin, and offer ourselves completely to Him. God desires for us to commit ourselves and our ways to Him. Okay, so let me read today. I'm going to read some of the ones we've done, verses 1 to 4, and then 5 and 6 of Psalm 37. So if you take your Bibles, you can turn Psalm chapter 37. Do not fret because of those who are evil, or be envious of those who do wrong. For like the grass, they will soon wither. Like green plants, they will soon die away. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Take delight in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. Now the text for today. Commit your way to the Lord. Trust in Him, and He will do this. He will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn, your vindication like the noonday sun. Heavenly Father, I pray that as we just look at this word and examine it, we receive directly from you today. Pray that you will challenge us. You will call out to us. Those who are perhaps caught in a cycle, oscillating in their spiritual reality rather than following and progressing, moving just kind of back and forth rather than actually forward motion. You call us to follow, and you are not walking in circles. You have a purpose and a plan and a mission. You came onto this earth, Jesus, to preach good news, and you are continuing with that mission today, and you've called us to partner with you. Send us the Holy Spirit to help us. And so, Lord, I pray today that you would breathe life into those who hear these words. And it might be like food to hungry stomachs, like fresh water to thirsty mouths. We receive from you today as we look at this word. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Okay, so first of all, the word there is commit. Now, this is a dirty word today. I mean, commit. No one wants to commit. I mean, we want to just kind of, let me pencil you in type of society today. And I think it goes without saying, before we can commit our ways to God, we must commit ourselves. This is what it means to, and if you've never done this, if you want to know more about this, I would love to be able to pray with you today. That you just choose today. You may have heard, you may have been coming for another number of Sundays. You may have read your Bible before. You may have heard about this or observed people that said they're born again. You may have seen and observed this, but you've never made the decision to say, I commit to following Christ and receiving salvation today. And if you've never done that, it's the first time, then I'd love to pray with you today. Or if it's a fresh commitment, maybe it's a long time ago that you made this commitment, or you said, I've always gone to church. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about who your parents followed or who your friends followed. I'm talking that you made a decision to say, I am going to receive Christ. I believe in God. I believe that he sent his son for my sins. I confess that I am not perfect. I need a Savior to cleanse me of my past and to guide me into my future. If you've never made that decision, that's what it means to commit your life to Christ. Be saved from sin and from yourself. Just committing myself is not enough. I need to commit my ways to God too. Now, speaking of committing our ways, and I just wanted to be careful of doing this, but I believe it is fitting and appropriate. But Erica has been serving for so many years, over 15 years in Matthew 25. And she's been delivering items to individuals. Started as a teacher, teaching engineering students. And but on her off time, spare time, she had a need and just felt the Holy Spirit speaking to her and met that need. And so there was a family that needed some furniture and some goods. She called a few people, collect some up, and got it there. And it started rolling out for a number of years, delivering things to people that had need. And gradually from one into a storage center, into a bigger place, and then a place in downtown in Welland, and delivering more than just furniture, though. Delivering more than just items. Because if you've talked to Erica, you will know that she would also desire to deliver hope. Even more than just hope. She delivered Jesus to people. I know that sounds kind of funny to say, but it's what she did. In fact, I remember every time I get a report, I get a monthly report and we review it and rejoice in what God has been doing. And she's very eloquent in the way she writes the reports and capturing meaningful moments. But all of them, you see a common thread, even when she comes in the office. And one of the first things she said when we met and we shared and talked a few years ago in the parking lot of the church, she said, just one more. There's one more. Always living for one more. She's not talking about one more bed to deliver to a home, or one more dresser, or one more microwave, or one more sofa. She's talking about one more person who is walking alone in this world, being introduced to what it means to walk with Christ and follow him. One more. Now, Matthew 25 is changing a little bit. We've given notice of the building, and so no longer going to be renting the building. And so it's not going to be delivering as much furniture and sofas, but I'll tell you what it is going to be doing. It's still delivering hope, and she's still delivering Jesus to those people that need it. That's not ending. When we talked about this, I remember Eric and I describing this, and she said, wondering about what's happening, I asked her the question. I said, Erica, are you feeling like you need to rest from delivering furniture? Yeah, I feel like I need to rest from that. Do you need to rest from delivering Jesus? And she said, oh, Pastor, I can't rest from that. I'm not done with that. See, she is committed. Committed not to renting in a building, committed not to furniture delivery. She's committed to following the mandate extended by Christ to her that came from the very mission of Christ himself. To go into the world and make disciples. What is the key to the Holy Spirit using you? I remember we did an interview a while ago with Erica.
She says, you just have to be obedient. You just have to do it. She said, if we really understood the urgency of those who are without God, how empty and difficult life is, if they only knew how great it was to follow Jesus, we would share our faith more. So I just mentioned that today, and not to just highlight an individual, and I wanted to make sure she was here. Where is she? Erica, where are you? Way back there. Bless you, Erica. Thank you. Thank you, Erica, for being obedient, continuing to be obedient, and making a difference. And you'll continue to make a difference as you serve God and we seek His direction. Keep making disciples. Salvation is the beginning, but it is not the end. We're called to go into the world, preach the gospel. We're called to make disciples. It's not a singular event, no more than commit is meant to be just one thing in the past. It's meant to follow. Never called people to just commit and stay. It's follow me. What were the disciples? Make disciples. Okay, so what were the disciples? People who committed to their masters, left where they were and who they were to follow him. Committing to God all my ways, not just the ways that I feel like I can afford to commit. It's a step of faith to follow Jesus. It takes commitment. It is a challenge. Commitment isn't about what I get out of it. It's not about I'm going to commit to God so I can get eternal life, so I can get forgiveness of sins. Commitment is that expression, how you are going to respond to someone who has laid their life down and committed to you. It's a reciprocal commitment. When you see someone that's willing to die for you, how do you respond with that? It's not that you're doing it because I can get something out of it if I commit, if I sign up and I pay a little bit here, I'm going to get better dividends in the end. I'm going to get a membership that gives me rewards. It's not that kind of commitment. It's the kind of commitment that happens actually after you've observed someone who's given you everything. Committing your ways unto God doesn't mean inactivity either, and I'm going to get more of this a little bit later. It doesn't mean sitting, I'm just going to commit it to God. And I'm just going to sit here and watch him do his stuff. We'll speak of that in a few moments. Turning it over to the Lord in my ways means I'm subject to his will. I commit to him and don't complain when he makes changes. Everyone likes God when we're following him, when he's leading us in the ways that are green pastures. We love his presence when we're beside still waters, even though sometimes he has to make us lie down beside still water. You ever try to make a kid have their afternoon nap? We know sometimes your good shepherd has to make you lie down beside still waters sometimes. Rest when you don't feel like resting. But even in those moments, you know, green pasture, still waters, I'll follow my Lord and Savior, especially in those ones. That's the greatest place. Lead me in still waters, green pastures. And there's that part about your rod and staff, but I'll just try to skip over that part. And when I go through the valley of the shadow of death, part. Well, you know, I'll follow my shepherd, but that valley of shadow of death stuff, and I know you said you're going to be with me, but can I wait here? Well, you go through the valley of the shadow of death for me? There's a continual aspect of commitment. It means following him and trusting that he's leading you in the right way. It doesn't mean that you opt out whenever you don't like the scenery. Trusting him, following him daily. A confidence. We see in verse 5 in the second part says to trust. We can trust that God really is who he says he is and that he will do all that he says he will do. Trust and commitment go hand in hand. What you trust, you will commit to. What you commit yourself to, you will trust. Now, I didn't plan on doing this, but I just have to. I've added this after the fact, but I it's important for some of the day. We talked about this at our board meeting. We were just sharing about, if you want to write down, I just encourage you, Psalm 25. You want to read through that? That's what we were reading over and discussing and feeding on as a board this week. And two elements. One was how God can take those and tell them in the way they should go when they go astray. So when you get off track, he'll let you know, this is the way you should go. You're kind of getting off track. And then he also leads people in the way who are on the right path. And so it's also important to know that when you're going the right way, but you're not quite sure, that the Spirit of God can say to you, yeah, that's right. Keep going. You got it. That's the right path. Keep moving. And so the Spirit of God can show us that we're going in the right way, shows us the right way, confirms the right way as we go the right way. But the Spirit of God can also correct us when we're getting astray by showing us the way we should be going. So as we're reading that, we're talking about, and something God's been stirring in my heart. I was driving quite a bit the last week or so and had a bit of a crazy schedule with some places I had to go. But what that means is I was able to drive and kind of talk to God quite a bit. And it was stirring in my heart something we talked a while ago about trusting in God and faith. And then I just share this with you. It's something that's kind of been working out, but I think it's enough worked out that I can share it with you, although it's not completely refined. But it's this concept. Pastor Carl and I were talking about this week as well, because I'm a verbal processor, if you hadn't figured that out yet. He came in my office, Pastor Carl, and we're talking about some more, and then he said, that'll preach. And then I said, okay, I'll preach it. But it's this. We think the opposite of faith or trusting in God, we think the opposite of that is doubt. I don't think so. Now, some of you are thinking, Pastor Jamie, I think you should have thought this through a little more. I don't think it is. I think the opposite of faith or trust is certainty. I think that's the opposite. Because when you are certain, you don't need faith. When you're absolutely sure, faith is redundant. You don't need it. If I've been there before, seen it 1,000 times, I'm confident in my surroundings, my ability, my circumstances. I don't need faith. I'm not talking about that kind of confidence. I'm not talking about confidence because, like David saying, I'm going to count how many people, and we are a huge army, we can face that enemy because we're huge. I'm not talking kind of the kind of confidence that a big, tall Saul can have in facing any enemies around him, because every now and then, when you're big and you're tall and your shoulders above everybody, like King Saul was, somebody else comes by, like Goliath, who's bigger and taller. So I'm not talking about a confidence in those things. You see, the difference between, I think it's not only that, and I won't go a step further, I think certainty is the opposite of faith. Faith is what? Is what is unseen. You're not certain. You don't see it. You don't know it for sure. So here I'll go a step further with that. And this was like, I think, on the second drive as I was working this over. Not only do I think doubt is not the opposite of faith, I think doubt is actually married to faith. I know some of you said, Pastor Jamie, I really would have hoped Pastor Call would have spoken a little more truth into your life when you had that moment this week. But hear me out. If faith is the opposite of certainty, if faith is to move forward despite of what is your circumstance and what you see and understand, then you see, in order to have faith, there has to be a presence of doubt. That thought, that wonder, say, I don't know. You see, doubt is not the opposite of faith. It's the launching pad of faith. When you're looking at that situation, you're thinking, ah, I don't know. You are that close to stepping out in faith and seeing God intervene. That close. You must have that level of doubt, that little bit of uncertainty, that sense to where thinking I might be in over my head here, I'm not sure if this is possible. That is the beginning of faith. So next time you have a little bit of doubt, if you're going to go and talk to somebody but you're not sure, you're going to go talk to your boss, you're going to give, and you're not sure if you're going to, whatever that situation is, you're going to pray, you're praying for someone who needs healing, and you got a little bit of that doubt, don't worry about it, don't stress about it, don't wait until you've removed all doubt before you pray for somebody. That moment's not going to happen, because if that person needs a miracle, it doesn't make sense, and you're not going to be able to understand it, and you think, this is going to be impossible, and I don't have the power to do this. That is when you step out and you trust God. See, doubt is the launching pad of faith. When you're facing a situation that you can't handle, and you know it and you admit it, but then you decide to turn to God, that is when you have faith. The confidence in who He is. Not only commit our way to the God, to God, but we trust His very nature. He is God. He never fails. He can be trusted. I remember our family singing a song through a crisis. My mom and dad singing, it became our family kind of song. God will make a way where He seems no way, where it seems to be no way. Rivers in the desert. It says, when you can't trace His hand, you trust His heart. He's too good. He's too kind. He's too wise to be mistaken. I trust who He is. I'm not just trusting in what He does. I'm trusting and have a confidence in who He is. So when you doubt, and you're facing that situation, when you don't know what to do, then you trust in who He is, that He's a God who does know what to do, and He's a God who can speak and tell us the way we should go. When you're facing a situation and praying for someone who is sick, you think in yourself, I don't know how this is going to work out, I'm not sure. But then you step forward praying, believing that God is a God who is healer. You trust and have a confidence in Him. You get the message. Verse 5 says, then trust in Him and He will do this. Confidence. Compensation. The last part of verse 5. What will He do? He will make your righteous reward shine like the dawn. Once we show our commitment and trust to Him, He is faithful in displaying His blessing. He will make it shine. Others will see. God not only proves Himself, He proves His people. Those that put their faith and trust in Him, He does not leave them on the wayside. It is not a wasted investment when you invest in God. God will show the justice of our cause in living for Him and putting our faith and trust in Him. Don't be seduced by this world that says when you go to church, when you serve Him, when you spend time reading your Bible, when you spend time on spiritual things, that you are wasting your time. You are investing in eternal dividends when you serve the kingdom. We benefit completely when we trust God completely, is what this text is saying. You do not lose out when you are sold out. Control. I want to flip a little bit farther, and if you kind of just go buzz through a bunch, but verse 34. Put your hope in the Lord. Again, that trust and that hope. Put your hope in the Lord and travel steadily along His path. I want to speak about timing and control. Wait for the Lord or put your hope in the Lord. How? By keeping His way. When I talk about committing yourself to God, it's not passive, it's active. We are to keep His ways. To wait doesn't mean sit still, but it means to remain faithful while you're waiting. God's sense of timing is different than ours. His sense of timing is from an eternal perspective. Ours is from a temporary. As a result, many times, like Martha, we see God late and we think that somehow he has missed us or our need or perfect timing. When we commit our ways to God, it means we commit who we are and our ways and trust that he is who he is and he is never late. And so what happens is, though, how do you test our commitment is when you say, God is never late. God is good and he's never late. And then if it looks like, on our perspective, that things have gotten worse, like Martha with her friend, with Lazarus, Jesus' friend, you are too late. We start looking at things and thinking, it starts to eat away at our commitment. We're saying, I was committed, I committed my way to him, and suddenly this thing didn't turn out the way I had thought it. Now, recognize God is never late. You think of Jonah, when he was swallowed by a whale and he was sinking deeper, as he testifies in his book, when he was thrown over to die by those who were in the boat, he was not too late. He delivered Jonah. He was not late for Lazarus, even though Mary and Martha thought so. He was not too late. In fact, he brought Lazarus back to life, and Lazarus continued. And one of the greatest moments is in Luke chapter 12, when they're sitting at the table eating, as if, like, well, yeah. Hey, remember that time when you raised me from the dead? You know, kind of a moment. Just back to doing life together. It was not too late. It was not too late when Pharaoh's army was pursuing and the people of God were fleeing and they came to the Red Sea and now we're done. They might think it's too late. It's not too late. It was right on time. Close those waters to not only deliver his people, but to deal with the enemy. Abraham and Sarah, God gave them a promise, and it took a long time for that promise to get any traction. Sarah, 90 years old before the first child, this promise of enough children that it can fill the sky with stars, I don't know if that's really. Think of Joseph, had a dream. It took a long time. Some being sold as a slave, being tricked, being imprisoned, and yet all along committing his ways to God, and it was not too late. He was put in the position, his dream fulfilled in time for him to not only provide for his family, but a whole region. And when God sent his son, thousands of years went by. The Old Testament history, and the bridge between the old promise and the new promise, the Old Testament and the New Testament, happened as well. But Galatians 4 says, in the fullness of time, God sent his son. What it means is, when it was the right time to send his son, he sent his son. So I ask you the question before we kind of draw to a close. What do you think God has been late in doing? You've committed your ways to him, you trust him, but you're feeling a little bit like it might be too late now. Can I encourage you once again to hold on? Tighten your grip on his promises. Hold fast to your faith in him. Trust him. He is not late. So why not trust him? So now, who is this message for? Is it for those people that have never put their faith in Christ? Sure it is. Yeah. Is it for those that need a fresh commitment to Christ because they've perhaps been a long time since they've trusted in God? Sure. Yeah, it's for them too. You know who it is for? It's for all of us. Let me take you, just as we conclude, to Luke chapter 9. As we come to the communion table in just a few moments. Luke chapter 9, verse 22. I'm going to read this, verses 22 down to 26. This is Jesus speaking to the crowd. And he said to all, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me." And then he said to them all, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me." But he just said that, but we'll get there. "For whoever wants to save their life will lose it, but whoever loses their life for me will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world and yet lose and forfeit their very self? Whoever is ashamed of me and my words, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his glory and in the glory of the Father and of the holy angels." Taking up our cross is a daily requirement for all who call him Lord and Savior. All are called to all in. A total commitment to the Lord and his call. The New King James Version in verse 23 says, "He said to them all, and if anyone desires to come after me," and it's kind of an interesting pairing of two words, come and after, and without getting it all into the Greek and stuff, it's just, the two words together means to follow or to come after someone, to be in another person's close proximity, blindly following them. General statement about disciples, about you and about me. So I guess what I'm saying today is just fall in. All in. Line up with where he is leading. And if you're going your own direction or opting out, you are missing out. The call today is to make a fresh commitment to follow him. I have the worship team come and those are going to serve communion. There's that part in this verse about carrying cross. There's a lot of verses that talk about carrying our cross. He says it twice. He says to them all. He's talking to disciples here as well as talking to the crowd. But it's very clear that this message went past just speaking to those who have been following him to all of the crowd who followed him as a crowd. I can't help but see the call to those who are following the signs and the wonders, following what he's saying, following the masses. But there's a call to be more than just someone who crowds in, but someone who takes up a cross. Following Christ requires a daily sacrifice. Don't hold back. We have an issue with holding back. Popular definition of the cross here is kind of like, have you ever heard the phrase, this is my cross to bear, right? That kind of definition. Because we're thinking, this is my burden, this is my struggle, this is my challenge. Kind of a figurative, this is my cross to bear. I'll tell you what, unfortunately, this is not a figurative use as Jesus is speaking here. He's not saying, take up your cross, your burden. He's saying, if you don't die, you can't live. That's what he's saying. He's not saying, you got to just take up a challenge. Here's the aspects of it. First one, you must deny yourself. You must die to yourself. Die to your own way, go in your own direction, your own purposes, your own agendas. You need to put aside and count yourself as dead to the old way, the old sins, the old you. Second of all, take up your cross. It's like the same phrase that was used for Simon of Cyrene. It literally means to take the position of an individual who is dead. Take the position daily. Every day, daily. Interesting part of that is then follow me. Concept central to following Christ. Walking along with him wherever he leads. Deny yourself, consider yourself dead to your own ways, to yourself, and alive in Christ. Paul talks about this a lot. and again, when you read this, David Boyd spoke to the young adults last night and got me fired up on this kind of a... So if you like, you know what, for the purpose, for those that are English majors, and I am... But as I started reading this, it's really interesting the way this phrases. If anyone would come, that's a present tense continuous action, after me, he must deny, which is a single moment in the past, consider himself dead. And take up, which is now a single action in the past, his cross daily and follow, which is present tense continuous. Here's the deal of it. It means that the key to continually following Christ is to consider yourself dead and to every day get up and to remind and consider yourself daily, I'm dead to myself, I'm dead to my own way, it's not my agenda, it's God's way today. And the secret to you living out continuously a life that would follow Him and His Holy Spirit leading you is to daily die. That's what it means. To get up in the morning and say, Jesus, today's your day. You died for me. I am died to me. But I live for you today. Interesting. Now as we're going to take and I'm going to release in a few moments just those to serve you. Paul, and you hear, just I'm talking about this, and this is, I'm reading now from a section that Jesus talked in Luke, but as I describe that, you can hear Paul speaking, can't you? I die daily. I mean, this is kind of the stuff that he lived out and preached. I have been crucified, Paul says, with Christ. I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. See? He got it. He got it. That's why he could live so with such a full abandon towards Christ and his purpose. As for us, why do we endanger ourselves every hour? Paul says, I die every day. I mean that, brothers, he says. Just as surely as I glory over you in Christ Jesus our Lord, if I fought wild beasts in Ephesus for merely human reasons, what have I gained? Wow, there's a real good job description. Put that on your resume. Fought wild beasts for Jesus. We endanger ourselves every hour. I die every day. So as you receive the emblems today, I want you just as you receive them, we sing. Remind yourself of the commitment that God had made to you in sending his Son. The Son saying, not my will, but yours be done. Receive them today and receive also the mandate to live a life that would be not my will.